Hello and welcome to another session of Pioneers Talk. In the 80s, PC companies were on a mission to bring a PC into every home. Today, data scientists are on a mission to bring AI, artificial intelligence, into every company. We have Sonja Strasser with us today. Welcome, Sonja.
Hello.
Hey. Sonja is one of the data scientists at Primetals Technologies, and we're going to investigate what AI can do today in the business context. So Sonja, my first question to you, what are the most attractive AI applications for businesses these days?
I think an application is attractive if you can use it in your daily work. So meaning that you use AI for monotonous repetitive tasks where AI is quite good to do it. And you can use your human resources in the company for in a more useful way. This is one aspect for an attractive solution. Another aspect is depending on the type of problem you are solving. So, for example, you can detect quality defects on your product with AI, and maybe you can also find out the root cause why there is a defect. But it would be better and more effective if you use AI to do it right in the first time. Yeah, so that you use AI algorithms to give you recommendations how to do your process or improve your process to get a really good quality already in the first run.
So with this kind of quality system, where is the data coming from? Is it sensor based? Is it data from previous production runs, historical data in a sense? Is it all of the above?
If you are training a machine learning model, you can only use your historic data because you can't look in the future.
But not yet.
And you have to decide which kind of data is relevant for the task you want to do. So if you are looking at quality, the input material of a process is relevant. So knowing what is coming into the machine, what is the chemical composition of the product, but also the process parameters. Sometimes also the process parameters from the previous production steps can be relevant, depending on the application, and also from the current process that you know what's the temperature in your plant, what are the pressures, how does the cooling system work, and things like that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Can you say generally the more data you have, the better as a starting point?
Not only the quantity of the data, it's also the kind of data. So do you have the relevant data for the thing you want to do? And also, how is the quality of the data? So it doesn't make sense if you have a lot of data, but the measurements are wrong.
Okay, no, that's for sure. Are there any AI applications that are really easy to implement? In other words, low-hanging fruits among the AI applications?
Yeah, if you want to start with implementing AI, I would recommend to start in an area where you have already data. As we discussed before, you have already sensors installed, you collected data for a certain time range, and you know also the quality is good. Then I would start with just a small solution first, so which is really fast to implement, so you can get really quick insights in your performance and what are the benefits of your solutions. And then also you can the employees working with the solution also can gain trust step by step.
Okay, I actually think it's interesting that you mentioned trust here. Is it similar to user experience with Google, for instance, search engines, where they input certain data and unknowingly input data, and then almost magically there's the result, and they really don't know how that result came to be. And to some people, that's a little spooky. So this trust issue in the business context, is it similar?
Yeah, I think you can compare it. So people have to know what is the input of the AI solution, what is behind the algorithm, how does such solutions work. So I think that's an important topic, that people accept these solutions and use it.
Is that also a reason why some companies are slow to adapt AI?
Yes, there are several studies which examine what are the biggest challenges for companies in implementing AI. And one of the big topics are the skills. So in some of the companies, there's a lack of knowledge and skilled employees who are able to do this in the company. Also, the costs for developing and implementing AI is a topic why companies are hesitating, because in many cases you don't really know the exact benefit you can get out of such AI solutions. Yeah, and there's a kind of risk to do big investments and without knowing what are the benefits.
So why exactly is it that you don't know the benefits? Do you have to, is that because it's a new situation altogether? Is this because you're looking for something where you can't quite tell what you're looking for?
I mean, you should really clarify first what you task you want to solve and what you're looking for. That should be clear from the beginning. But what you can't tell at the beginning is this information really covered with your data you collected? So is it really possible to learn this from your data? So do you have enough data? So there are some rule of thumbs, you don't know really if it works and how good it works.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. So we just discussed this slight hesitation in some companies to embrace AI. Is that also true for the metals industry?
I think in metals industry there are some companies which are quite good in implementing AI, but I think not all companies have the resources to do this on their own. So in this case, we at Primetals Technologies also can support our customers from collecting the data to building first prototypes, measure the performance, and if the performance is good, deploy the model, monitor the model, retrain models, because we have here a strong team consisting of data engineers, data scientists like me, software developers and domain experts to cover this whole life cycle of an AI project.
Maybe we should just explain to the audience real quick the concept of a domain expert. So Sonja, correct me if I'm wrong, okay? But I believe a domain expert is someone with great metallurgical expertise and someone very familiar with the production process the AI would be implemented in. And so if I understood you correctly, the idea is that combining domain expertise with AI and the strengths of AI, that this is a package that is almost unparalleled, because two worlds are combining to form something special.
Yeah, I think this is absolutely necessary when you implement something in industry, because AI doesn't work that you just collect a huge amount of data, put it in a deep learning model, and then you get out the thing you want. So,
okay. So what does the domain expert contribute there?
Yeah, if you prepare the data, you have to have a clear understanding what this data tells you, how it is recorded, how you can pre-process it, because without knowing that you can make many faults.
Okay. Is it also about determining what's redundant and what's actually essential?
Yeah, this is also, I mean, there are also algorithms who can detect or select a certain kind of signals out of a huge range, but it's also good to confirm this selection by domain experts.
And are there any applications in the metals, in the world of metals, that you feel are extremely important for AI?
there were a lot of possibilities to apply AI in metals industry, I think. So one area would be, for example, the quality management. So, for example, you can use predictive models to predict quality parameters of a product already in advance. So this gives you the opportunity to take countermeasures if you see that your product is likely to be outside certain tolerance ranges.
And so the data from which the AI would make this prediction is all, everything we discussed earlier and more probably. So what other applications?
For example, computer vision is a very very good technology you can use in steel industry. So you can place cameras which monitor your process, and they can tell you, for example, which kind of scrap is loaded in an electric arc furnace, or you can use it to inspect the slabs which are casted and detect surface defects, things like that.
Oh, that's interesting. Okay. You mentioned earlier that AI excelled whenever it dealt with repetitive tasks that, you know, human beings would be bored with maybe, or not fast enough. So in terms of replacing humans, not altogether, but in certain areas, are there any of our senses that are more easier to emulate, easier to substitute?
I mean, there are many senses which can be replaced by technologies. For example, the human eyes, you can use cameras, or you can use microphones to record sounds like our ears do. There are different sensors where you can feel temperature or pressure, for example, and this can all serve as input for deep learning models, and deep learning models then can learn to distinguish between different sounds or different objects you see on an image. And there is even smell you can distinguish.
Smell? I thought smell and taste were our domain and remained our domain.
There is research also in this area where specific biosensors record and data and deliver the input for also for deep learning algorithms. Yeah, maybe there are useful applications in some industry, like food industry, for example. Yeah.
So no sniffing in no AI based sniffing in the steel industry for now.
At the moment, not.
Okay. And that also means that as humans, we're not going to be replaced completely anytime soon.
No, I don't think so. So if you're looking at the tasks an AI solution is doing now at the moment, is a quite well-defined task. But if the situation is changing and you are outside of the known problem space, then AI solutions would fail. So humans are very good in solving complex problems or solving new problems. And for AI solutions, it's very limited to transfer a solution from one application area to a completely different one. Yeah.
Sure. And when it comes to creative processes, I believe that there's some AI-based music or some AI-created music.
Yeah.
And I listened to that and I felt that it was very unoriginal, so I didn't feel inspired. And I also read some texts that were written by AI and, well, same thing, not very inspiring. Of course, flawless, right? There were no typos. But I did feel that there was no real targeting, so no target audience in a sense. So if I write you an email, I will address you in a different manner than I would address the audience, for instance. And so it seemed to me that that was not something the AI was yet capable of. Is this something you can confirm, or is there, should we be prepared?
Yeah, I think you're right at the moment. Yeah, it works, it delivers some text, also AI is able to generate things like text or also images or music, like you tell. But I think it's not in the quality we are used from human beings. So I think AI will improve in this direction, but it will take sure quite some time that it nearly the ones like
okay,
human.
Okay, at least there's some time. But I think one area where AI has gotten quite good is deepfakes.
Mm-hmm.
So deepfakes would be images, videos, audio, where mm-hmm. you're seeing a speech by Sonja Strasser, mm-hmm. but really it's AI generated. Mm-hmm. It looks like you, it sounds like you,
mm-hmm.
it's not you.
Yeah.
Is this on the rise?
Yeah, this arose in the last years. So deep learning algorithms generating these things, generating images, videos, swapping faces there or cloning voices. And this, yeah, will develop more and more and gets harder to distinguish if it's fake or not fake for humans. But there are also research efforts to use, again, AI, ironically, to detect this. So, yeah, and maybe similar, like you have, you detect spam mails or you have an antivirus software on computer, maybe in future you will have a software which gives you an alert if you are watching a fake video.
Mm-hmm. So does that mean if the CEO calls you mm-hmm. and or the CFO calls you and he says, please, Sonja, I want you to wire 100,000 euros to this bank account. Just before you do it, the AI will alert you and tell you that the CEO is fake and it's not the CEO.
Yeah, could be possible. But in this case, I hope also my common sense will
I'm sure. I just used you as an example.
Yeah.
Sonja, my last question to you today. Do you have a favorite AI application of the many applications that I'm sure you've worked on?
You mean application I'm using or?
Maybe applications you're using, but yeah. also applications in your personal life.
Mm-hmm. At the moment, it's an application which detects formulas in documents. So
okay.
For me, it's quite helpful because it translates a formula from a picture or also from handwritten text and translates it in a format what I can edit and I can use for documentation or presentation. And for me, it's helpful. Maybe not for the majority of the people, but for some.
Wow. Yeah, I would need AI to just understand the formula.
Yeah.
And maybe AI wouldn't cut it.
So,
Sonja, thank you very much for this conversation about all things AI. That's the end of this session of Pioneers Talk, but we'll be back with another session very soon, and I look forward to seeing you then.